In today's module, we'll be looking at forecasting or predicting on the basis of a given time series. In the previous modules, we have looked at how to fit a good model to a given time series. So, we have looked at the Box-Jenkins model, and previous to that, we had looked at the classical models as well. So, there are different ways that you can fit a model, but the main purpose, as we have said very early, that there are two things that we look at when we look at a time series. Firstly, we need to smooth the time series out, and this we do primarily to do the forecasting. So, the second thing that we do is forecasting, predict future values based on the past smooth values, and that is what we are going to look at today. And primarily, we will be concerned with the classical model, the Box-Jenkins model. And we will be introducing a new type of technique, which is somewhere in between the classical and the Box-Jenkins model, which is referred to as exponential smoothing. First, let us look at what is forecasting. It is the process of predicting future values of a series based on current and past values. Now, very often the terms forecasting and predictions are used. Now, these are quite synonymous. So, one in loose terms, one can use either forecasting or prediction synonymously. Now, forecasting is usually specific to a future time point, and predictions are generally, it refers to all future time points. So, we will not make this distinction as we go along. So, we will be using either one of the two terms, meaning the same. But what we mean by this is that, for example, we say, what is the weather going to be like on Sunday? Is it going to rain on Sunday? You have a cricket match, and so you want to know this, and you will say that it is forecasting. Predictions would be what is generally going to be the weather in the coming days. So, it will refer to a general future, whereas forecasting usually is specific to a future time point. Some of us, the people, are pessimistic, and they will say that, okay, Sunday wouldn't have rained if you didn't have a cricket match. So, forecasting takes into account sometimes other factors as well. Now, what is the problem here is that, given the observations x t. So, we have n observations on x t at time points t equal to 1 to n, and we would like to know what the value of x is going to be s steps ahead. That means, what is the value going to be at the time point t plus s. There are different methods we have used in fitting time series, primarily the classical approach and the Box-Jenkins technique. So, we can use them to forecast future series. In this case, we will also look at a different technique, which is referred to as the exponential smoothing technique. So, we will be looking at forecasting from all these three viewpoints. Now, let us start with the classical approach. We start with an additive model, which is x t is equal to t t, which is a trend, plus s t, which is the seasonality, and epsilon t, which we will be assuming to be the error component. Now, as usual, the error is assumed to have expectation 0. So, what would be the predicted for the error? Obviously, the estimated predictor for the error would be 0. So, we need not bother about the error when we predict. That is the fluctuations or the randomness that we have, and we will be expecting the future value to be independent of this, or on the average it is going to be 0. Then you have the trend component. Now, when you have the trend component, we would fit the trend by some method, either the moving average or the curve fitting method. Suppose we use a quadratic trend, and let us explain this through this quadratic trend. So, we have t t is equal to a plus b t plus c t square. And then what we do is, we use the least square method to solve for a, b and c. Now, once we get the estimates of A, B and C, then if we substitute this A, B and C, we can write T t as A hat plus B hat t plus C hat t square. And therefore, the predicted value of the trend at time point t plus s would be t plus s hat is equal to A hat plus B hat into t plus s plus C hat into t plus s square. It is simple, you just replace the time point t by t plus s in the trend equation and you get the future trend value. Next we will look at the seasonal component. Suppose there are k seasons and the STs have been estimated as xi 1, xi 2 and xi k. Remember that the seasonal factor only depends on the particular season, it does not change over the different years or months, whatever we are looking at. So, it is specific to the season. So, the same season over different years would have the same seasonal value. Now, suppose our t plus s time point is in the jth season, so it coincides with the jth season, then s at t plus s would be the same value as xi j. And once we get this xi j, we can have s t plus s hat and then we have the seasonal component estimated. The final predicted value of x at time point t plus s is then x hat t plus s, which is equal to the predicted trend, that is t hat t plus s, and the predicted seasonality, which is s hat t plus s. And of course, the random component does not come in. So, this is how we can predict the future values when we are looking at a classical model. Now, let us look at the exponential smoothing technique. This is firstly used when there is no trend or seasonality, this is how it was devised, but later on they saw how you can actually account for trend and seasonality even in exponential smoothing. We will also look at those, but for the time being assume there is no trend or seasonality. Now, if you look at xt plus 1, the xt plus 1 is a linear combination of past values. So, it is an infinite lag model of its own past values. Let us write this as xt plus 1 predicted. This p is equal to c naught x t plus c 1 x t minus 1 plus c 2 x t minus 1 etcetera into the infinite past. But then you have too many parameters generally, and we can also say that as we go further back the impact of that x value on t plus 1 would be less and less. So, it is logical to assume that the coefficients decrease, and we will assume that they decrease exponentially. So, we will assume that the c j's are given by alpha into 1 minus alpha to the power of j, where alpha is between 0 and 1. This is for all j equal to 0, 1, 2, etcetera. Now, if we use this c j values here, then what it happens is that x t plus 1 p becomes alpha x t minus 1 plus alpha into 1 minus alpha x t minus 1 and so on and so forth. So, keep the first term aside, that is alpha x t. From the second term onwards, take out 1 minus alpha as common. What remains is alpha x t minus 1 plus alpha into 1 minus alpha x t minus 2 and so on and so forth. This you can see easily that this would be your x t predicted. So, x t plus 1 predicted can be written as alpha x t plus 1 minus alpha x t predicted. And since alpha is between 0, 1, we have x t plus 1 predicted as a convex combination of the current observed value x t and the current predicted value x t p. And starting with x 1 p equal to x 1 and then going to x 2 p and so on so forth, a smooth series can now be generated. So this is why it is referred to as exponential smoothing. And the future value, the predictor obtained is a convex combination of the current observed value and the current predicted value, can be extended to xn plus 1 as well, given x1, x2, xn. So what we have is xn plus 1 p would be alpha xn plus 1 minus alpha xn p. That is the one step ahead predictor. But we need not go too far ahead here, because we have assumed that there is no trend and there is no seasonality. So likely the values would be on a flat scale when you plot them, and hence one step ahead predictors would translate to two step ahead predictors, etc. And we can predict the series. So you need only to predict one or two values. But the problem very often is that we don't have series without trend and seasonality. So what if there is trend? In that case, Holt suggested an extension of the exponential smoothing technique, and this we will refer to as Holt's forecasting method. Now suppose the model is xt is equal to mt minus 1 plus tt minus 1. Mt minus 1 is the mean level of the process, that is the level at which the process would have been if there was no trend in it, and tt minus 1 is the additional trend effect. So it's a combination of a mean level and a trend level. Now given this model, xt plus a should be, since we only have data up to t, would be mt plus the trend h times. So each time you get a trend, that would add on. So it will be trend added on h times, and we'll get xt plus h as mt plus h tt. Now how do you get this mt tt values? The mt values are the mean values. That's exactly what we had before, where we had no trend. So the mean value now again is a convex combination of two things. What is the current value, that is xt, and what is the predicted current value? The predicted current value would be the sum of the predicted value of the mean from the mean level, mt minus 1p, plus the predicted value from the t minus 1 step, that is the trend value in this case, that is tt minus 1p. So one is the predicted value from the previous step and the other is the current observation. That will give us mtp. It's a convex combination like before. Just in the exponential smoothing, we didn't have the second term tt minus 1p, otherwise it would have been the same. And now we also need to update the trend value. So the trend TTP would be again a convex combination, taking a factor beta which is between 0 and 1. The first component is MTP minus MT minus 1P. MTP we have already got. Look at MTP minus MTP minus 1. This is the two mean levels at time T and T minus 1. And their difference would actually give you the trend. So this is the trend that you have at the t minus 1 level. And you are combining this with the predicted trend value from the t minus 1 level, that is tp t minus 1. And this gives you the updated trend value at the time point t. So once you have got this, we substitute this in xt plus h to get the predicted value of xt plus h as mtp plus h ttp. And you see that all these are known, we have calculated this from the past data, and hence if you want to predict 8 steps ahead, then we can use this xt plus hp by the Holt's forecasting method. Now suppose we also have trend and seasonality. So the seasonality is a added factor now. In that case, we have xt plus h is mt plus h tt as before, and we have the seasonality factor Ct plus H or Sc plus H added to it. Remember, we are looking at an additive model. So there are k seasons with Sc plus H as the seasonality at time t plus H. The model becomes Xt is equal to Mt minus 1 plus Tt minus 1 plus Sc. And we update as before, first of all the mean level as a convex combination of two things, the mean level at the previous step and the predicted mean level. Similarly, the trend as a convex combination of the predicted trend and the trend as estimated as a difference between the two mean levels, and similarly for the seasonal factor, which is again a convex combination of the past seasonal factor predicted, that is Cp or Sp t minus k plus 1, and Xt minus Mtp, because H is equal to 0, this becomes equal to Ct, and hence we can get another value from this, and we take a convex combination of this two. Then we can predict Xt plus H as Mtp plus H Ttp plus Ct minus k plus 1p. So this is how we can do the whole twinters forecasting, which is primarily an exponential smoothing technique which accounts for both trend and seasonality. Let's go back now to the Box-Jenkins model. This is the final models that we have seen, and how can we predict on the basis of this models. Now there is a very important result which can be shown, that is, given the past observations x1, x2, xn, the best linear predictor for xn plus h, which minimizes the mean square error of prediction, is MSE xn plus sp is equal to the mean square is expectation of n plus s minus xn plus sp square, that is the mean square error of prediction. This is minimized if we take xn plus sp as the conditional mean. So, we will write this as xn plus s star, which is the conditional mean of xn plus s given xn, xn minus 1, x1, and this would minimize the MSE. So, this would in a sense be the best linear predictor. As an example, let us look at the AR model first. You have xt is equal to alpha xt minus 1 plus epsilon t. Now, substitute n plus s instead of t, and you write this in terms of the past values, we have done this before, and you can write it, if you go back up to xn, it will come out as alpha to the power of s xn plus the combinations of the epsilons. Before we had even gone further back, not we haven't stopped at xn, we have, you can use the same model, maybe xn can be written as alpha xn minus 1 plus epsilon n, etc. But we will stop here at alpha or at xn, because we have observations up to n. Now, if you look at the expected value of this xn plus s given the past values, then you can see that the second terms are the innovations and their expectations are 0. So, this reduces actually to alpha to the power of s xn. So, that is the predictor. So, if you are given xn, you do not need xn minus 1, xn minus 2, etcetera. The last value is xn, and each step you go, you multiply it by alpha. So, if you go s steps ahead, it would be alpha to the power of s into xn. And you can calculate the mean square error, that is the difference between xn plus n and xn plus s star. Take the difference, which would come out to be the second term in xn plus s, first term cancels off, and you square it and take expectations, and you land up with these being equal to sigma square into 1 minus alpha to the power of twice s by 1 minus alpha square. And you can see that as s increases, alpha to the power of twice s decreases, and hence the whole value tends to increase. So the further you go ahead, the more is going to be the error. So you should be careful not to go too far ahead if you don't have good estimates of alpha. Predicting one or two steps is good enough, but if you go too far ahead, then probably the predictions are not going to be so good. Let's look at another example of the MAQ process. Here you have xt is beta naught epsilon t up to beta q epsilon t minus q. Beta naught, of course, you can take it to be identically equal to 1 at times. And in this case, the predicted value is xn plus s star is summation j equal to 1 to s q beta j epsilon s plus s minus j. Now, if s is less than q, if s is greater than q, obviously you are too far ahead, and remember all these are innovations with expectation 0, so you will not be able to predict on the basis of this given series. So, s has to be less than q, and you only retain this q terms because all the other terms becomes a 0 otherwise. And then again you can calculate the MSE, which comes out to be sigma square summation of beta j square. Again this sums up to s minus 1, and hence this will also be increasing with x. So, again don't go too far ahead in predicting. There is one problem, you need to estimate the epsilons. And how do you do that? Because you see in your xn plus s star you have a lot of epsilons. You can use the residuals from the innovation algorithm, there will be substitutes for your errors, so the innovations, and hence the residuals in the innovation algorithm can be used. And what you actually get is xn plus s star is equal to j equal to s to q beta j hat, which should be estimated, into epsilon hat n plus s minus j, where the epsilon hat should be the residuals, and you can do it if s is less than q. Finally, let us look at the ARMA 1-1 model. In this case, again you can calculate xn plus s star, you just have one step here. And you get this in terms of the epsilons and the xn, that is the last values that you have. Again, the epsilon need to be estimated, and you can calculate its mean square error as well as before, and hence make the predictions. Now, what we generally need to look at is we will be looking at an ARMA PQ, and what we always do is that we have the estimated model. That is, the parameters of the model are estimated, and what we are trying to do here is to predict. Hence, we will be using all the values available to us, and then we can be using them as follows. If you have future values of epsilon which you do not have, you take them to be 0, because on the average they are 0. So, if you do not know them, take them to be the average value, which is 0. All future x values can be substituted by their predictors. So, if you have xn plus 2 and you want to predict this, it will be depending on xn plus 1. So, what you do is given xn up to xn, you predict xn plus 1, take the predictor xn plus 1 hat and use that in xn plus 2. So, future x values can be substituted by their predictors, but all x and epsilon values can be substituted by the observed and estimated values. Why both? For the x's, you can substitute them by the observed values, the epsilons are unknown and hence has to be estimated. As we saw for the MA process, we can use the innovation algorithm and the residuals from them to solve and get these values. So, use the past values, either the observed for the x's or the estimated values, and then now you have everything that you know need to, and you can forecast the future values on the basis of your model. In today's module, we have discussed how we can forecast or predict from a given time series. We started by looking at the classical model, where we had the trend and the seasonality, and saw how we can forecast on the basis of the predicted trend and the predicted seasonality value. Then we moved on to the exponential smoothing technique, and the exponential smoothing technique can be with or without the trend and the seasonality components. So, we extended it to the Holt's method and to the Holt-Winters method. Finally, we looked at how the forecasting can be done when we are fitting a Box-Jenkins model. We saw this through special examples of the AR process, the MA process and the ARMA-1-1, and we can generalize these results to a ARMA model or even to a ARIMA or a SARIMA model.